Parenting is a sacrifice. It's exhausting. It's expensive. At times it feels thankless, but eventually you die. My wife hates that joke. My wife is amazing. Even in the most stressful moments, I will catch her looking at me with an expression that could only be described as regret. But she's Catholic, so there's no quitting the team. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, come on. How y'all doing this morning? Come on, y'all feeling good? Thank you, Jesus. Hey, listen, let me tell you what we're thankful for. We're thankful that you get up and come down here, bring your family and your friends, dude. It means something to us. So give yourselves a round of applause for getting up and being here. Come on. Seriously, dude, this is a message in a series that's very important. And I know how it is when you get in a series like this. Sometimes people are like, oh, I don't know if it applies to me or not, or if it's going to help me or not. Well, this is a series, I promise you, if you just listen and you go, all right, God, speak to me, show me, he will show you what it means for you and your family specifically. So thank you for tuning in or for being here, because it really is why we do it. It's to make sure that we help you, again, take that next step with God, whatever that looks like. And it can look like a lot of different things, and we'll talk about a little bit today. Now, the thing about Simple Church, we also like to laugh and have a little fun with that, because we know parenting is difficult. It's hard. And it's one of those things where no matter what stage you're in, whether they're grown or they're still growing, you kind of look back and go, oh my gosh, you know. But hopefully, through a little laughter, through a little, again, scripture references and driving you to that, you'll go, okay, I can get through this and I can learn something. So to have a little fun, to take the next little step, is I saw this Gaffigan special and I have to show you a little bit more because I love him and he's talking about parenting. But one thing I cannot relate to, I only have 3 kids, he has 5. Let me say that again. Pray for Jim Gaffigan. He has 5. But here's a little fun as he talks about that and how people react to that. Check it out.
My 3-year-old's now 4. I also have a 9-year-old and an 8-year-old and a 2-year-old and a 1-year-old. I have 5 kids. I used to have more, but I ate them. 5 kids. I love it, but I don't know what happened. 10 years ago, I couldn't get a date. And now my apartment's literally crawling with babies. It's like I left peanut butter out or something. Strangers, for some reason, think I'm unaware that it's a lot of kids. 5 kids, that's a lot of kids. Oh, you think so? Thanks for the heads up. Do you mind if I stab you in the head? The best is when I'm alone with my 5 kids and inevitably struggling, and some stranger will come up to me and go, looks like you got your hands full. Why would you say that? It's like going up to someone in a wheelchair. Looks like you don't do a lot of dancing. Looks like you got your hands full. Yeah, I could still punch you. But it is a lot of kids, you know? We've jumped the shark. Because when you have 4 kids, people are like, wow. But when you have 5, people are like, just stop. What are you, creating your own nationality? Settle down. Is there going to be a country called Gafghanistan? Make a plan. Some people think it's religious. They're like, yeah, but those kids for religious reasons. That's not how it works. If anything, you have 4 or 5 kids, and then you become religious. Because once you lose a kid at the mall, you know, atheist or not, you start talking to God right away. Hey, God, I know I haven't talked to you in a while, probably since finals in high school. Anyway, if you could help me find my son, I promise I'll change my life. I'll stop going to Wendy's. Oh, there he is. Never mind, God. Well, we're off to Wendy's. Do, 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 do.
Come on, man. Give it up for old Jim Gaffigan. That's why I love him. He knows how to talk about life and get you to laugh about it, but at the same time, learn a little something, and that's what the goal is today. So, speaking of learning something, last week I ended with this verse. It's found in Proverbs. Check this out. Train a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not turn away from it. So I did a little bit more research on this, and I thought about how I was pretty quick to just throw it up there and have a great scripture and say, okay, go for it. Get out of here and enjoy that scripture. And then upon research, I'm like, there's a lot more to that one little scripture than I probably made clear. One thing that I underline is what we're going to focus on today, the way he should go. It's an overlooked part of this message, and I want to make it clearer today, particularly for this generation, because for my generation, it was not very clear. We just threw it out there, and the generation before that was like, just train up a child the way and go, and it'll be good. Well, here's the deal. It is a proverb, not a promise. So every parent just went, uh-oh. Because this is one of the things that happened in my generation. Parents, preachers would say, this is it, man, train up a child the way and go, and he won't turn from it, gets old. But the one thing that gets overlooked and was not clear until I studied a little bit more on this, the difference between a proverb and a promise. So I know some of you are asking, well, what's a proverb? What's the difference? I mean, good question. So let me define a proverb for you. Here it is. A general truth about life. It is a piece of advice. That is why when you look in the book of Proverbs, you would say it is truth, but it doesn't necessarily apply all the way across the board. It is not a promise from God. It is saying, we want you to do it. I'm not saying it's not, but don't think that it's going to guarantee that's what's going to happen, because there are always exceptions. When I tell you there's always exceptions, just think about you growing up with kids that you grew up in church with, and then you look at them in their adulthood, and you're going, maybe they're going to come around, right? That's the thing, is it doesn't guarantee it's going to happen. So then I even did a little bit more research, and I thought, but can I give a celebrity illustration of this? Someone who grew up in church and was there all the time, and then what happened in the end, right? Well, here's a picture of him. You're like, that's Halloween. No, that's Marilyn Manson. Very active in church, grew up in a Christian home, went to a Christian school. That's not your poster child, is it? You're like, golly, what? Well, here's the thing. There's always exceptions. It is a general truth. It's going to apply for sure. But when you're a parent and you're battling failure and you're going, oh, I messed up and I didn't do it. No, the truth is, man, every kid is an individual. And you're trying your best to train them up and figure that out. And then sometimes they go their own way. And that doesn't mean you failed as a parent. That is called free will, choice. That is why sometimes we battle, well, I don't understand, it doesn't make sense to me. Well, that's why we're trying to help this generation be better than the one before us. We're going, all right, let's learn and look at it a little bit different. Now, it's true, I am not a biblical scholar nor a parenting expert. You know that. If you know me and you've seen my family, and if you have been in the Simple Church and you've seen the way I've grown up, I am not some deep biblical scholar. But the one thing that I am trying to do is understand a little bit clearer the things that sometimes people just said in previous generations, and we just accepted it. But I'm going, all right, now wait a second, God, what are we saying for this generation? And what did we need to make clear? Because as we get, again, taking these steps through generations, you learn a little bit more and you can apply it. You can actually apply it to your circumstance, your situation. So this is what I want to do today. I want to explain the how of this idea of going their own way, the way we should go. How? What does that mean? Well, upon further investigation, when you look in the actual language it was written in, which is Hebrew, so if you go Old Testament, front half of the Bible was written in Hebrew. The back half of the Bible, New Testament, was written in Greek. So if you look in Hebrew, this is the very interesting phrase and the actual definition of the way they should go. According to his way. Now you go, well, that's pretty similar. Kind of, but here's the difference. I'm going to break it down into three things, this according to his way, what that means, and it's going to be three parts to this. And it goes right along with this series that we're talking about, and as I looked at that, I'm like, I need to make that way more clear as we proceed. The first way to, again, break this down is the stage of life. Now, this is very obvious, but it's not so obvious when you're in it. You go, well, what do you mean? You got a kid. You got a grandchild, and you're trying to raise them up. You will teach a preschooler way different than you will teach a college student. Can I get an amen somewhere? You understand that, like, a preschooler doesn't understand everything, but a college student, man, they're way more advanced when it comes to their thinking and their processing. Now, that sounds so silly and so stupid. You're like, well, of course, but let me go back in time to previous generations, one being my generation. I grew up in church, and while I was in church, they taught a sixth grader the same as a 12th grader. Student ministry was sixth grade through 12th grade. And it didn't matter that some of us had gone through puberty and some of us hadn't. They taught us all the same. They said it doesn't matter. They can learn just as fine. They'll be fine. When the truth was, it was complicated. Some things didn't make sense. We didn't grab a hold of everything. And then I became a student pastor back in the 90s, okay? And when it got into the 90s, I remember I took my first job at a church and came in, and they had middle school and high school all together. All students were taught the same. And I got in there, and I didn't really know much, and I got in there, and I'm looking at trying to teach a sixth grader the same lesson as I'm trying to teach a 12th grader. It doesn't work. They're not on the same level. I mean, sixth graders were picking boogers and poking each other and everything else, and seniors over here going, man, what are we doing? Let's get out of here. Let's blow. We don't want to be here. And they had other things on their mind, and it was this weird, and you're going, wait a second, what if we divided them? And now, as crazy as it sounds, and again, 2019, everything's divided. It's even subdivided even more. We try to break it down as much as we can because we understand you don't teach every kid the same thing at the same level. You have to break that up. It's by stage of life. So a preschooler, that's why I told you last week, we're talking about 0 to 1 and 2 to 3 and 4 to 5 and then preschool. You after you go through that, and then you go into kindergarten, K-1, then 2 through 3 and then 4 through 5 and then middle school. They've been trying to put sixth grade separate from 7th and 8th. There's a lot of talk because now we understand the development and the way things are happening. That's what that scripture was breaking down. Thousands of years ago, it's going, listen, they don't all learn the same. Teach them according to their way, stage of life. That is brilliant, but went overlooked. How do you say it was overlooked? Because for all of the generation I grew up, we didn't divide it up. That is also why it's important to understand why these ministries are created in a church. When I grew up, we didn't have children's ministry. We didn't have all those things. We were a smaller church. They just threw everybody together. Kid just needs to learn. They'll be all right. That's why we were bored out of our mind. That is also why today in modern world, we have preschool ministry and simple kids, and then we have middle school and we have high school. Why? Because we're going, listen, man, get them in that appropriate age teaching so that they can learn something and it applies to their life. No, we love it when they're coming here. Somebody caught me after the early hour and they're like, well, I guess I picked the wrong day to bring my kid in. I'm like, no, man, they can always come in here. But what we would challenge you to do was come to this church. That's fine. Come to the big service, as whatever you call it. Be going to big church today, and then make sure that they're in an age-appropriate teaching at some time. Why? Because they can learn something. They can be around other kids, and the lesson is designed for them. So if you don't, they can miss that, and then they don't have those connections. They don't have those relationships. They don't have all of those things that are fundamental to teaching them how to grow. Now, the second part of it is, in today's culture, I think you would admit that we're growing up way too quick. If you were to look at modern culture versus past, man, it was like we're on hyperspeed. I mean, one of the reasons why, and I'll just give you one example, is this right here. The cell phone. Right now, like fifth graders, fourth graders, hey man, when am I getting my phone? I'm like, what? Do you realize how crazy this is? But it is the culture. Next thing you know, be a first grader, kindergartner. I need my phone, man. Where's my phone? I'm like, that's what is happening. They're growing up way too fast. Now, how do I know this? I have three. I'm watching it happen. I'm seeing how kids dress. I'm seeing what they want to watch. I'm looking at what they want to do and how they want to go. And this culture is moving, 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 moving. So sometimes I just want to push the brake and go, can't we just slow down? Can't we just slow down? It seems like just yesterday they were born and now here they are wanting to go. And it's like, man, everything in between. And even as parents, we can be so guilty of it too. It's like, I can't wait till I'm out of this phase. Oh my gosh, when can you get out of diapers? When can you go to school? Dude, it just goes. If you keep pushing it, it's going to keep going. And so what I thought this week is I sat in the office and I was like, man, how could I illustrate this? Or what could I do to kind of get us to press the brake a little? It's a great song. It's a great video. Now, I got to say, I cried in my office when I watched it. So judge me, if you will. But it's probably because I got graduating kids. My kids are older. So maybe wherever you are in the phase, maybe it won't affect you that way. But as you watch this video, just get one thing. Maybe we parents, maybe we kids should just slow down a little. Watch this. All right. So you're in the dark. That's a good thing for you. I have to just be right out here. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, all right, Lord, help me. Because you and I both know it's moving quicker than any other generation. Everything's on a rapid pace. Hurry, 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 hurry. So my challenge in this series, and as you're watching online or you're in this room, slow down. Slow down. Enjoy each stage because it goes like that. Appreciate the stage that you're in, and then teach appropriate based on that stage. Have them in church. Bring them. Put them in the right places. Why? So that they can have those memories. You can have those memories, and you can get a break. You know, if nothing else, parents, you need a break. That's why it's upstairs. It's a great thing. Get a break. You got 45 minutes. Take it. Number two, according to his or her way also means according to their strengths, according to what they're good at. Now, why do I say that? Well, because I'm a parent. And so when I look at my kids, sometimes I'm too close to see their actual talents. We're so close to them that we overlook some things that other people see. It could be a coach. It could be someone in church. It could be their life group leader. It could be their small group leader that looks at them and says, man, you know what your kid's really good at? It's happened in my life. I didn't even know my daughter could sing. And all of a sudden, a teacher from school says, man, I heard your daughter sing one day. Why don't you encourage her to sing? And I'm like, didn't know she could. That's the truth. We kind of have different ways. You're so close to them. You're kind of going through life and everything's so fast. That's why it's important to appreciate the educators, whether they're in the church or in the world, and they look at your kid and go, I had a teacher write me a note about my kid that I still cherish to this day. Because she saw things in my kid that no one else saw. That's a gift. Appreciate those strengths and those differences and understand that every one of your kids is different and they don't have to be the same and they don't have to be like you. This is the thing. Sometimes we're just too close to see it. This is another reminder according to their way, not your way, their way. Galatians says it like this. Each person should judge his own actions and not compare himself with others. Then he can be proud of what he himself has done. This is the thing. Don't compare your child to you and your childhood. I know I'm tempted and I work through that same thing or what I was good at. I loved baseball. And this is probably one of the reasons, again, that I never really pushed Ian to do it. Now, a couple of times I'm like, hey, son, you want to play baseball? I loved it. He's like, no, Dad, I don't. And then all of a sudden they come home and say, Dad, we're playing soccer. I said, no one plays soccer. They said, Dad, everybody plays soccer. I said, not in the 80s. Well, like, it ain't the 80s, old man. But that's the thing is, that's the whole deal is you go, I can't compare my experience to their experience. I saw a parent yesterday, homecoming's coming up next weekend. And they're like, what our kids need is they need the way we did. I'm like, hey, newsflash, it ain't the same. And you can't compare your generation to their generation, and they need to do this because maybe it's going to be different. Maybe there's different strengths and different things they do, and that's okay. Sure, there's things they can learn from it, but don't try to force your way onto them. It could be very different. Don't compare yourself to that. Don't compare them to you. Number three, parents, listen, grandparents, listen. Each kid has their own temperament and personality. This is so critical. This is probably the biggest eye-opener for me right now. Is it should be obvious, but it hasn't been in my life. We're doing a study right now as the staff, in the church staff, and it's called I Said This, You Heard That. And it is, again, from Andy Stanley and North Point, and it is a great study that just talks about personalities. And they divide the personalities or temperaments into four colors, red, yellow, green, and blue. And it makes it a little bit easier. It doesn't get heady. You know, Enneagram was awesome. Evan talked about that, and those are great things. But sometimes it gets a little, oh, my gosh, it's overwhelming. I'm a simple guy. It's red, yellow, green, blue. I think I can handle that. So as we're going through that, I've known some of these staff members for 20-plus years, but I don't think that I understood their temperament until recently because going through these studies. I mean, some of these people I've known longer than 20 years, and I've messed it up. I found me pushing my temperament on them or them going, well, this is the way I am, and it's very messy and sometimes can be hurtful. Well, it's no different in a work environment. It can be even worse in a home environment. So if you don't know your kid's temperament, if you don't know what color they are, if you don't know the way they're wired, it can mess you up. We're going to be doing this series coming up right after this one. So it's going to be another great thing to do because it applies to work, home life, marriage, kids, all of it. But here's the thing. As you go through it, you got to understand that we're all different. And so you may not understand the red, yellow, green, and blue. I'm going to give you a 30-second little clip, and this is the thing. In this little clip, it's going to show you the different colors and some of the things, that the goods and the bads of those. I'm going to go ahead and tell you what I am and see if you think it lines up. I am a yellow red. So if you go, what's Justin? He's a yellow red. So here is just a little bumper, a little insight to what this study is all about. Watch this. There you have it. Now you know I'm loud, I interrupt people, I'm bossy, you know. Those are things that if you're in my family, you're close to me, you're like, yep, yep, yep. My wife is a green, the opposite. Patient, harmony, you know what I'm saying? And I'm going, now she has a little yell in her as well, but this is the thing is as you begin to figure it out, you're like, oh, that's different. I understand, but here's the big one. Go back to your kids. So I'm bossy, I'm a red. Hey, you need to do this, you need to do this. My son's a yellow. All my kids are actually yellow. There's some other colors in there as well, but they have some energy in there. But I should be yellow, I should understand, but sometimes I hurt their feelings by the way that I communicate. Because according to their way, I'm not even caring, I'm not even understanding, I'm not sensitive to it. Now you go, well, that's part of parenting, dude, that's the way it is. And that's how we mess up. And so let me prove it to you. While we're sitting in the office this week, we're watching this video because as a staff, we're downloading all this. We're talking about trying to be careful with our words with each other and how we're doing things. And they comes up a clip about parenting. And the green guy, this guy is actually green in the video. That's his temperament. He's telling a story about his dad and the way that interaction went because his dad was red. Listen close and you'll understand why I want you to understand what temperament your child is so that you can better, again, be better than the previous generations and not make the mistakes that we've made. Watch.
I grew up with a dad who was more red, more choleric.
Okay.
Choleric?
Mm-hmm.
More red, more choleric. So he had to, and there's probably some melancholy too. He had, when he would teach me to do something, it had to be just right.
Okay.
So mowing the lawn, I had to mow in straight lines and get every blade of grass. And no matter how hard I tried, he would find the spot that I missed or that I didn't do perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that, I would get frustrated and get down on myself or angry
right.
And would not feel respected, would not feel like he's trusting me with this and letting me go.
Yeah.
Felt like he was micromanaging it.
Yeah.
So that was difficult. And at times, I'd be like, oh, I just want to give up.
Mm-hmm.
So one time in particular, I remember going into our garage after, and I was about to go up the stairs, and he had gotten on to me for something. I don't know if it was mowing the lawn or something else, but he had gotten on to me, and I started to tear up and cry. And as I did, like, he had been going at me pretty hard with his words, and as I did, he backed off, and he said these words that I will always remember, just that he didn't want to break my spirit, that God had given me a gentle heart and a gentle spirit, and he didn't want to break that in me. And he showed me respect.
The reason that touches all of us in the room, but particularly me, I have broken my child's spirit at times. Unintentional, but because I'm a red, and they may have been a yellow, and they're wanting to have fun, and I'm trying to, hey, you need to, and the next thing you know, you see it in their face. I have broken my friend's heart, said things in the wrong way, or come across too harshly, and I'm going, all right, God, I don't want to keep making those same mistakes. I don't want you to make the same mistakes. If you're a young parent in here, or you're even an older parent, you're going, oh, I don't know what my temper of my kid is. We just were raised, you just do it. You just suck it up, and that's the way it's supposed to be, and they should just do this and do that. And if they don't, well, the truth is, you can do it that way, and you can mess up. And this is the thing. It doesn't matter if it's friendship, or if it is coworkers, or if it's your family, your brothers, your sisters, your mom, your dad, your kids. You got to understand, and that's what we're trying to do, help you be better than we had it. Learn a little bit more and understand according to his or her way means they're unique and different. And this is the thing. God works through different people in different ways. That's what 1 Corinthians said. They're not going to work exactly the same in every person. Your way is not necessarily the right way. And you're driving that home and you need to do this is not a way to win. The goal of parenting is not to mold your kids into your image. Do you know that? Do I know that? I'm trying to grab a hold of that. It's not that they become like you or that they do it like you or they perform like you. Love does not demand its own way, 1 Corinthians. You do it my way. You be like me or you're not going to be successful. Because the truth is, you and I both know we make mistakes. Parents make mistakes. People make mistakes. So I don't want to demand you do it my way because my way is full of mistakes. To lighten the mood a little bit, moms, you've made a few mistakes. Here's one example of that. Hold on to the kid, mom, for the family picture. We're not perfect. Sometimes you're going to mess up. That's a little dramatic, but you're going to mess up. Dads, don't get overconfident. Don't do what this guy's doing. The money in the little pond is not that important. But if you do want some advice of what to do as a parent, here's the thing that we probably should do. Just read it. Enjoy. Arts and Crafts 101, all right? It's my first day in kindergarten. I hate school and I refuse to hold a sign unless it said, I hate school. That's appreciating a temperament. It's like, dude, this is stupid. But here's my whole point of that. You and I both know everyone's different. All of it's challenging. We don't have a manual. We're trying to learn. Now, it's true. We're trying to give you resources we didn't have to understand each phase. And this is the parenting goal for us now. 936 weeks to help them discover what God has made them to be. Not what you think they ought to be, not what you want them to be, but what has God uniquely shaped them to be. And you understanding how to walk through each of those phases is critical to their development and the happiness of your home, the joy of watching them, of growing them up according to their way. Because that's the key component. You want to help them realize their uniqueness. There's no one on the planet like them. There will never be another one on the planet like them. That's a fact. Ephesians says it like this, for we are God's masterpiece. A masterpiece is signed by God. It is unique. There is not another one in the world, and it makes it priceless. It is valuable. And this is the thing. That's what he says about each and every one of us. And he planned for you to do some amazing stuff. This is what's awesome. There is a reason God shaped them that way. There's a reason they have those strengths. There's a reason they have those abilities. There's a reason they have that temperament. Quit trying to break it and mold it into you. Let them be who God wants them to be so that they can do what God wants them to do. Now, why is it so hard? This is the thing. I'm a parent. I got three. I know it's not easy. Why did our parents mess it up and why are we still messing it up? I'll give you two reasons. Cultural pressures are everywhere, but there's two that jump out. The whole idea of conforming and comparing. Conform, conform, conform. Everybody's doing it. It was the same in the 70s, 80s, 60s, all the way through. I mean, when we were growing up, it was like, man, you got to conform. You got to do this. I remember when some kids, we had heads. We called them heads. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Yeah, it's only old people. I don't know what y'all young people call them now. We called them heads. But smoking was a big deal. So they went to the head parking lot and smoked at Southwood. That's what happened. Well, now you're going, oh, yeah, well, that's just conform, conform. That's that group. Now you realize that this idea of conforming now is vaping. Y'all know what that is? Y'all heard of it, right? So here's the deal. It ain't just the head parking lot. Now, every kid in the world is like, man, I'm going to vape it up, man. Just vapor. Just vapor. What's the big deal? I see it in our kids. I've seen it in my kids. Even the church kids. Why? Because it's conform, 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 culture, culture, culture. Now we realize it, it'll kill you. That's the way it's been for every other generation too, hasn't it? Something, somewhere. And then it's, if it's not conforming, it's the pressure to compare yourself from income to IQ. How much money do you make? What's your job? How smart are you? What did you make? What did you do in this? I see it in my oldest right now. Hannah's about to graduate, trying to figure out what college she's going to. And all her friends, what'd you make on your ACT? What'd you make on your ACT? I can honestly say no one's ever asked me what I made on my ACT once I got into the real world. That's a fact. But the pressure is there, and it's real. Conform. It's this idea, man, you need to, again, compare yourself to somebody else. You're not as smart. You're not as good. You're not as talented. And when you're in that application process or high school process or middle school process and now elementary process, you're looking around at everybody else. Do I wear the same thing? Do I look the same way? Is my skin color the same? Do I have the same money? Do I have the same availability? Do I have the same smart? Dude, everybody, God made everyone unique and special for a reason. Quit comparing and trying to conform. You do you. You be what God's created you to be because there's something unique and special about you. Romans says it like this: quit. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Yes, that's talking about the way you view things. Change the way you think about it. Parenting. Change the way you think. Be transformed. Don't go with what the world's saying. God, how can I be transformed so that I can renew my mind and understand it at another level? As I was wrapping up the whole preparation for this week, I thought of this while I'm typing and I'm going through. I'm raising kids. I'm going, man, this is difficult. And I remember trying to conform. And I remember, again, trying to compare myself to others. And, you know, my parents didn't really always do it right either. So, but they did celebrate some things. If I'd never sung a note in my life. Y'all, I did Christian music for a while and all that. But in high school, I'd never sung a note in my life. But my parents, I thank God they let me go try Christian music. I left my job and moved to Nashville. I'm going, thank God my parents didn't go, you're crazy, you're out of your mind. They're like, go for it, son. So some things they didn't do right, some things they did. And then as I look back, we were in church all the time, so I'm thankful that they put me in church. I'm thankful I had those things because you don't get it right all the time. But it ain't no guarantee because other friends were there and they're not in church. So I'm going, all right, how do I end this message? And this is probably the most powerful part. Because it applies to even you who don't have kids in this room. Even you who think this message is, well, maybe it'll apply to me one day, or man, I'm past that, and you're going, it doesn't really, what, how does this apply? Pay attention right now. This is why it matters. What you sow in one season, you will reap in another. That is not a proverb, that is a promise. It is saying that what we put into this generation right now will benefit us in the future. So if you're teaching a kids class, I saw some of you this morning, I saw your shirts on, saw your name tags, thank you. Because even though you're not, you don't have kids or you're not in that phase, you're going, no, I'm gonna sow. I'm gonna put something in this kid's life. I'm gonna invest because one day I will see the benefits from it. If you're an older generation, you're going, what difference does it make? Oh, it makes a big difference for your future. Is what we put into this generation, why we go through these series and why we invest in this is because we want it to be different. We want the world to be different, and that happens when we invest in it. The scripture says it like this. Put it on the screen for you. Don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God, right? What a person plants, he will harvest. The person who plants selfishness, ignoring the needs of others, is ignoring God. They will harvest a crop of weeds. Do you want to know why we're putting shoes on the feet of kids and why we're asking them to bring batteries for firemen and why we're putting the do-good store up and giving the proceeds away and doing all, because we're going, we don't want our kids to be full of selfishness. We don't want to raise, we want to plant something other than that in them. Die to self, serve others, give. Don't just come to church to get. Find some way to give. That's because we believe it's important. And we'll have I love this. And he'll have to show for his life these weeds. But the one who plants in response to God, letting God's Spirit do the growth work in him, harvest a crop of real life, eternal life. What you plant in now matters. Not just now, getting you the real life, but eternal life. So here's the last part that sometimes gets overlooked and forgotten. So let's not allow ourselves to get tired doing it. Let's not allow ourselves to get fatigued in doing this good of investing of sowing, because at the right time, you'll harvest a good crop if you don't give up, if you don't quit. Right now, therefore, every time we get the chance, let us work for the benefit of all, starting with those closest to us. Who could they be talking about? Maybe your family, maybe your friends. So you don't get tired of doing it. You don't throw in the towel. You're going, no, it matters, because what we're planning right now, you will see in the future generations, and it changes the world we live in. And it's no, you know, news flash to anybody. This generation needs us more than any other generation. They need us. So if you're a parent here and you brought them to church, you did great. If you're a grandparent, you're going, man, I'm trying to figure it out. You're doing great. Just keep investing in, because they need you. If you're a volunteer, a worker, if you walk out and see kids and you just use your words to benefit, that's part of it. Because as you'll see in this closing video, they need us. They need us. Watch.
I'll find myself wanting to please the crowd.
I'll find myself wanting to please the crowd.
I'll need you to remind me that I should obey God.
That I should obey God.
I'll act like I don't have any problems.
I'll need you to show me how to share my struggles with others.
I want to have a lot of money so I can buy what I want.
I'll need you to teach me that my things belong to God.
That my things belong to God.
I'll struggle with my looks and appearance.
I'll need you to remind me that God wonderfully made me.
I'll tend to think about myself before others.
I'll need you to teach me that the last will become first.
The last will become first.
The last will become first.
I'll think I'm a lot smarter than I actually am.
I'll think I'm a lot smarter than I actually am.
I'll need you to show me how to learn from God's wisdom.
I'll want to avoid hard conversations.
I'll want to avoid hard conversations.
I'll need you to show me how to speak the truth.
In love.
In love.
I'll look for happiness in many different places.
I'll need you to show me that joy is
found in following Christ.
I'll find myself stuck in bad habits.
I'll need you to show me the way out.
I'll need you to show me the way out.
I'll need you.
I'll need you.
I'll need you.
I'll need you.
To point me toward Christ when no one else will.
To point me toward Christ when no one else will.
That video, so yeah, go ahead, give them a clap. Awesome, great kids. Here is the thing. That's why this series matters. That's why it matters that you're here. They need you. If you want to volunteer, volunteer. If you want to invest in your kids, find some ways to invest. But let me tell you something. Having them in a church is a key part of that. And having them in the right church, the church you go, man, I like, that's what it's about. I grew up in a church that was religious, judgmental. Many times it didn't do the right thing. It wasn't ever about serving others. It was all about what was in it for them. The Simple Church is striving not to be that. We want to follow Jesus and die to self and serve others. And I want my kids to get that more than anything else. That's why we go out of the country. That's why we challenge them to serve and get involved and find ways for you, because it matters. Let me tell you how I know it matters and why it matters. I'll put a picture of an image of a guy right here in the church. This is a child in our church. His name is Jude. And Jude, his parents serve in middle school and high school, and they have for years and years and years. And as a result of serving in those areas, when you have a child that's, again, the parent of someone serving, we have a class called Hands and Feet, and my wife, Angie, teaches it. So they don't have to go the same thing. If they go to, you know, 9 o'clock children's services or whatever, they have the 10 o'clock, they can go to Hands and Feet. It's because it gives them something different. Well, Jude is my wife's favorite. She's not supposed to have favorites, but she loves Jude a lot, way more. She's like, oh, I love Jude, I love Jude, I know, honey. Well, Jude came home the other day and said, man, Dad, I'm having a hard time swallowing. Sitting at the table, he couldn't eat. And they're like, oh, you know, you just need to eat. And he's like, no, something's wrong. Pulls up his shirt, and he has a massive bruise on his chest. And they're like, we're going to ER. They rush to the ER, they get there, and they go, man, we're moving you from right now from Shreveport-Bossier straight to Memphis, to St. Jude, because we think your son has cancer. And Jude this morning, right now, is in St. Jude, battling cancer. And Mike and Tracy came to the 9 o'clock hour because they came home to get stuff at their house, and they were coming back. And I said this in all 3 hours, but I want to remind you of something. Why is it important to care about what phase you're in? Why is it important to make church a priority as far as trying to serve or come? Is because your kids are learning and watching from you. And you don't know what the next phase has to offer. So in the middle of all of this chaos and things that are going on, what was awesome is to watch you as the church rally to try to help them. We got a word pretty quickly that they were going to have to change all their furniture out in their house because Jude's cancer is very, very challenging for the immune system. And they had animals before, so all their furniture's got to change. We made one phone call in Johnson's Furniture, some good friends of ours, Stillman and Chris and Zach and all, and said, we'll handle it. Don't worry about furniture. We got that covered. And I'm like, okay, couch, chair, mattress, done. Then we got back, like, man, that's crazy. And we're like, hey, there's some stuff that needs to be happened. They're going to probably have to clean their house at a deep clean that really is beyond next level clean. Not like just a mop and shine, but like really serious germ eradication. And Putman Restoration, Putt's a good friend of mine. He's like, dude, I got it. You tell me when and we'll bring in all of our stuff and we will put the best possible cleaning in the market in that house for them for nothing. Then I'm like, well, there's some things that need to be remodeled. I mean, we may have to take out carpet or put in a different floor. Multiple builders, Donnie being one of my friends, Jim Mesker, they're like, hey, all you got to say is tell me the word and we'll go in there and make that happen. Let me just say this. What you plant in one generation, you will reap in the next. You will harvest in the next. All of the talking about giving back, all of the talking of, hey, how can we serve, all of the talking of, again, saying this is who we are and what we're about as Jude's grown up in it and seen it time after time and heard it. But let me tell you something, he's living it now because this is where his parents put him in. This is where his parents said, this is the value, this is who we want to be, and they lived it. They've been middle school volunteers, high school volunteers, all these things are going on, and now they're in the middle of a crisis. And what do you do? How do you navigate that? How do you get through this phase? You get through it because you got a church family and you got friends around you that are willing to help. I say all that because Jude knows that we love him. We'll be praying for him. We've got a lot of stuff coming up. But there's one thing that I'm hoping that we can do today as well. I don't ever talk about money unless I give it away. You know that. That's the simple church way. It's the way it's been from the day we've opened. Well, one of the things that I want to be able to try to help them do is get their travel expenses handled because they got to come back and forth between Memphis now and home because they're trying to both work and they can't work and you can imagine the chaos. But I said, don't worry about it, Mike. We're going to figure it out. We will help you figure it out. Now, again, it's just one story. It's one person. But let me tell you something. We try to do it for as many as possible, solve as many problems as possible. But the only way we do it is because people like you go, man, if it was me, I want you to try to help me. And we don't get it right all the time, and we can't do it for everybody, but we do our best, and we try our best to do that. So if you're willing to do that, or you're in a place where you can do it, man, write a little check, put it on there, put Jude, whatever it is, and it will go to, how ironic is Jude is at St. Jude, and how thankful we are for St. Jude. When you talk about KTBS, and you talk about what they do in this community, dude, that is an organization, St. Jude, and that partnership is critical. Philip and those are dear friends. This is why we do all that. You're investing, you're planning, because you know one day you're going to see the reward, the harvest of it. So that's my prayer, that's my challenge to you, and help, hopefully, prayerfully, you understand why these series and this message is so important. Because we don't know, but thank God he's been in every one of those environments as he's grown up to hear that God loves him, that he can trust him, and he should obey him and do whatever he asks him to do. And Jude's like, God's going to get us through it, we're going to figure it out. That's what I want, that's what you want. So would you pray with me as we pray for Jude and as we pray for us as families, as parents, as grandparents, as a community? Father, I pray that right now Jude would understand how valuable and important he is, that he is unique, he is special, that he has gifts and talents and abilities, that you have planned for him to do some amazing stuff. Help us, God, to understand how we raise our kids, and it matters that Mike and Tracy brought him to church every week. They volunteered and served, and he saw that. That he experienced that love, not just from his parents, but from outside adults to say, hey, this is why you're important. This is why you're valuable. This is why you matter. So now that when the world is falling apart, he can rest in you and he can rest in those relationships. Help us, God, to heal him. God, through medicine, sure, but through a miracle if it's necessary. And God, I also just pray for all the other families and people in this room that are watching online that they would understand it's not just for Judas, for them as well. But God, that you love each and every one of us with that unique kind of love, the kind that God will sacrifice and do everything you can to demonstrate that love, not just talk about it. Help us to be that same way as a church, God, not to just talk about it, but to demonstrate it. I love you, Jesus, and I thank you for what you've done for us, and I thank you for every volunteer and every parent and family that comes to this church. Help us, God, to be a little bit better than the generation before us, and help us to plant into this generation to prepare for the future. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Can I get an amen somewhere? Come on, one time. All right, I had to hurry because, dude, it's 4 minutes and Dallas is already down 10. I'm just kidding. Here's the deal. You can get one of the books if you want out front. They are available if you want to give it as a gift or whatever. It's a great way to do that. Also, you can, again, help us in any way you want with giving and on the giving stations or online, whatever you want to do to help us. It would be wonderful, all right? I love y'all, dude. Thank you for coming. I can't wait to see you next week. And until then, I will say peace. Thanks for coming.